Alright, let's begin with the Taylor series today. And we begin with the geometric series. So do you remember the formula for geometric series? If you have like 1 plus 1 half plus 1 fourth plus 1 eighth, how do you calculate this? Formula is A over 1 minus R, right? So what should I put on the top? 1, then 1 minus, what's R?
1 half.
Yeah, 1 half, right. So you end up with 1 over 1 half by the 2, and then you get 2. By the way, does anyone have a scientific calculator?
I do.
Get it ready, because we're going to use it a little bit later. You're going to help me, okay? All right, so. The same way, by the way, the formula I'm using is A over 1 minus R, where A is the very first term, and R is the common ratio. So let's see if you can do the following. What if I have 1 plus x squared plus x cubed? What would this mean? Yes. You're going to use it when I ask you to. Okay, so what is this equal to?
1 over 1 minus x.
Yes, 1 over 1 minus x. Because the common ratio is now x. You keep multiplying by x, and that's what you get. All right, so next is, well, so far there's nothing surprising about this. We've been using this for quite some time now. But things become interesting once you start integrating. Okay? So we're going to integrate both sides. We integrate 1, I get x. Integrating x, you get 1 half x squared plus 1 third x cubed plus 1 fourth x to the fourth, 1 fifth x to the fifth. That's equal to, let's see, this looks like f prime over f, except that the derivative of the denominator is negative 1, so you really want this to be negative 1, right? So we make this as a negative, negative 1 over 1 minus x, and using the formula, the integral of f prime over f gives you ln of f, right? So that's the formula. So we have, we first put a minus here and put a minus there, so that's still the same thing, and then once you recognize this is f prime over f, I can put integral as ln of the denominator. Okay. That's what we have. Now if you plug in 0 both sides, you get 0 on the left side. You get log of 1. Log of 1 is also 0, so this does work. I'm saying this because usually when you integrate, you need to put plus c on one side, but then I'm saying that that c would be 0. Okay, so this is what you would get if you plug in, if you take that equation and integrate both sides. Now, so far, we just integrated. Nothing seems to be that special. But let's see what happens if we let x equals to 1 half. If x is 1 half, what is the claim? X is 1 half plus 1 half times 1 half squared, 1 third 1 half cubed, and so on. Maybe just do one more. 1 fourth 1 half to the fourth. Where on the right side I have negative ln of 1 minus 1 half. Let's do a little bit more computation here. See, this is negative 1 times ln, 1 minus 1 half is 1 half. But then this can jump over the log and put here. This ln of 1 half to the negative 1. But what's the negative 1 power? That's the reciprocal. So it's ln of 2 over 1. So we have an equation that will tell us what log of 2 is. Log of 2, according to this series, it has to be 1 half plus, let's let's see, it should be 1/2 plus 1/8. This will be 2 cubed is 8, 8 times 3 is 24, so it's 1 over 24. 2 to the 4th is 16, 16 times 4 is 64. So that's what we get. And 1/2, as you know, it's 0.5. 1 over 8 is 0.125. And then 1 over 24, well, 1 over 25, if you divide 1 by 25, you get 0.04. This 1 over 25 is like 4 times 24. 4 times 25 is 100. So if you divide 1 by 24 instead, it's going to be slightly bigger than 0.04. So it must be 0.04 something. It's if you round it from the next digit, it's 0.042. Okay, and then plus 1 over 64. I have no idea what that is. It's definitely 0.0, it's less than 0.02 because 1 over 15 is 0.02. And so I would say I'm going to take, I guess, probably 0.01 up to 66. Can you help me here? What is 1 divided by 64? 0.0156. So if I round it from the next one, it would be 6. Okay. All right, so we have this much. If I add these two, I get 0.625. Adding these two, if I add these two, it's 0.058. So if I have 0.058 added to 0.625, I'm going to get 0.683, right? Now, we truncated it, so there's more terms to be added, so definitely it must be bigger than this one. But not much more, because the things that you're adding is getting smaller and smaller, so I believe the approximate value of log of 2 is about 0.68 something, okay? Or maybe 0.69. Now, can you do this with a calculator? What's log of 2?
0.6931.
Oh, okay. Right? Yeah. I mean, if we added more terms, we probably ended up at 0.69. Good? Okay. Now, what we achieved is the following. We had log of 1 minus x expressed at some infinite series. Now the significance of this is the following. I was able to do this with pen and pencil without any calculator, right, on the left side. And the reason I could do the left side without a calculator, or at most with a four-function calculator, was because the only thing involved here is multiplication, division, addition, subtraction. Okay. Now when you have a polynomial function, then you can always evaluate it using multiplication, division, subtraction, addition. But once you have log, then you need a scientific calculator. That's what you've known so far, right? Yeah. Without a scientific calculator, you don't have access to these functions. But it seems to suggest that some intractable function like log can be accessed by a polynomial. The catch is that the polynomial has to be infinite order. So the immediate question that comes after this is that possible? Can we express other functions, not just the logs, but think about like exponential function, trigs, inverse trigs. Can these be expressed as infinite polynomials? And the answer is yes. Actually, the fact that it's true was known to the Indian mathematicians in the 15th century, except that their work wasn't known to the other people later, so the entire fact had to be reinvented after Newton. Newton, shortly after inventing the calculus, around 1663 or at some point like that, after a few years later, I think in 1669, he came up with this idea. But other people like before him and after had similar ideas, and they had some series related to that. Okay. Now we name such a series as Taylor because the English mathematician Taylor was the first person to write it as a textbook. So we put his name on, but certainly more people have seen this before him, okay? Including you. Okay, so what is this thing? It's an idea of taking a function like e to the x and writing it as an infinite series. Now, if you have a polynomial like 1x, x squared, x cubed, x to the fourth, and never ending, this thing on the right side is called a power series, because it's evolving it by the power of x, okay? And you hoped to find out what these values are. What is a0, what is a1, a2, a3, a4. And your aim is to have a functional identity. I want these two sides to be equal as functions, which means that they should agree whatever value you plug in. Now that's a hint for getting a0. How would you get a0? Any ideas? You plug in 0 for x. Think about what's going to happen to the right side. If you plug in 0, what's happening? Everything's 0. The only survivor on the right side is?
A0.
On the left side, you get e to the 0th power, which is?
1.
Oh, so I have a0 equal to 1. So that's a start. But then immediately when you try to go for a1, now you have problems because plugging in other numbers, you suddenly involve everything. If you plug in 1, you get a1, a2, a3, all of them survive, and that's no good, okay? So the really hard step is to think about the next one, which is not so easy to think. And the idea is this. If two sides are equal as functions, then their derivatives must be equal. This is not just an equation of x. This is an equation where the left and right are equal as functions. If that's true, then you can differentiate the left side and differentiate the right side, and they should still equal to each other. Okay. So we do that. We differentiate this, which still gives you e to the x. On the right side, a0 differentiates to 0. A1x differentiates to A1. What's next?
2A2.
2A2x plus
3A3
x squared. 4A4
x cubed
plus da da da. And now what? You plug in x equal to 0. The left side gives you e to the 0, which is
1.
The right side is
everything's
0 except
a1.
A1. Also, we found out what a1 is. Okay. How do you get a2?
Same thing.
Same thing. What? You differentiate both sides. Okay. We differentiate e to the x and differentiate the right side, which is a1 differentiates to 0, so you get 2a2 plus 3 times 2 times a3, 4 times 3 times a4 x squared. And notice that I'm not multiplying 3 times 2 to get 6, because I need to find the pattern. I can't be going forever, so at some point I have to stop and say, oh, this is the pattern, okay? In that case, it's better to just leave it as a multiplication rather than multiplying it out as a number. Okay. All right. So e to the x prime is e to the x. When you plug in 0, you get 1 on the left side, and on the right side you get 2a2.
Yeah,
and everything else is 0. So a2 is
One
over two. Okay, at this point, you should be able to do this in your head, okay? All right, can you calculate in your head, do some mental math to find out what A3 is? What do you get? One over six. If you differentiate, plug in zero, you get 1 equals 3 times 2 times A3, you get 1 over 6. But rather than writing as 1 over 6, I want to write it as 3 times 2. Can anyone do A4? 1 over? 4 times 3 times 2. Which is 24, 1 over 24. And then you start seeing some pattern. And we've seen this before. 3 times 2 is the same as 3 times 2 times 1. What's that? What's that called? Factorial, that's what it's called, right? This is 3 factorial, this is 4 factorial, this is 5 factorial. Now, that immediately tells us to look at this in a different way. See, 2 is same as 2 times 1, so that's also 2 factorial. What about A1? Isn't this 1 over? Same pattern, 1 over?
1 over 0, 1 times.
1 factorial. Okay, and then you can even say 0 factorial is equal to 1. See, 0 factorial doesn't have a definition because n factorial means you start from that number and keep multiplying things until you go down until you reach 1. Right? But if you have 0 factorial, there's no definition for it, except that when mathematicians were using factorials for other things, they realized if you allow 0 factorial to be defined as 1, if you just define 0 factorial to be 1, then a lot of the formulas become simpler to write. So you can really rewrite this as 1 over 0 factorial. And everything has the following. A of n is 1 over n factorial. Is that good? So that's the idea of the Taylor series. Taylor series is just repeat this until you see a pattern. That's what Taylor series is. So Taylor series of e to the x is 1 over 1 factorial, 1 over 2 factorial, 1 over 3 factorial, 1 over 4 factorial. You can even write 1 as 1 over 0 factorial if you want to make it, put it into pattern. Now, of course, what we have done so far would be just some fun activity if it didn't really yield to a real result. So let's try this. I know that E is 2.718 something. So let's try to use the first few terms. How would I use this to get this result?
Ln to the E to the X. Or
E to the what?
Ln.
No. To get e equals to 2.718, what should you let x equal to?
1.
So just plug in 1 into all the x's that you see. Okay, which gives you 1 plus 1 plus 1 over 2 plus 1 sixth plus 1 over 24 plus da da da. This is 2.5 plus 1 over 6 is 0.1666. 1 over 24 is 0.042. And then so and so on. And that's equal to 2.666, and then you plug in this, so it'll be 2.702. So isn't this really close to that, right? So that's what we see. this is the basic idea of Taylor series.